Most growers, when they talk about fleshing, are actually describing something called leaching. Also, a lot of folks think it's just something to do a week or so before harvest rather than periodically throughout the life cycle. So what is leaching? Well, it's really all about reducing the concentration of dissolved minerals around your plant's roots and in the growing media. Maybe you've increased your nutrient solution strength too quickly and your plants aren't responding well. Perhaps you've even noticed some tip burn. Not good. Example, you're growing hydroponically, let's say in a soilless mix, coco coir and perlite perhaps, and you want to feed your plants a nutrient solution at 1000 ppm, that's 2.0 millisiemens per centimeter. Anyway, you test the runoff and hey, look at that, it's all the way up to 3.0 millisiemens or 1500 ppm. No wonder your plants look a little frazzled, huh? So what can you do? Well, you can panic and top feed your plants pure water. That'll certainly lower the concentration quickly around the root zone, but it also risks creating a form of osmotic stress, plants struggling to adapt to sudden changes in solute concentrations around the roots. It's preferable to apply a dilute nutrient solution, say 500 or 750 ppm, that's 1.0 or 1.5 millisiemens, and water through, testing the runoff periodically until it's around your target, 1000 ppm. Note the symmetry between my corrective, more dilute nutrient solution and the original leachate reading. Why do mineral-based nutrients tend to accumulate in the root zone? I'm so glad you asked that! Remember, plants transpire to keep themselves cool. They uptake lots of water, but actually hold on to very little. Most of it simply passes through the plant and eventually back into the air through tiny pores in their leaves as water vapor. There's also a considerable amount of water lost to evaporation. Now, I don't want you to worry unduly about transpiration. It's natural and necessary, and well, it's just what plants do. But in the process of sucking up all this cooling water, some nutrients inevitably get left behind. In other words, plants uptake more water than nutrients relative to their ratio in the nutrient solution. This is why hydroponic growers who use recirculating systems top up their reservoirs with water or half-strength nutrients every day or two. If they neglected to do this, their plants would end up feeding on an ever-concentrating nutrient solution as time went on, eventually leading to toxicity problems and plant tissue damage. Leaching then starts with testing the leachate or runoff. If it's over 300 ppm, higher than your input nutrient solution, you top feed with a milder nutrient until the runoff is where you want it. Like I said before, if you're 300 ppm over your input, leach with a solution that's 300 ppm under. Some growing systems are more prone to salt buildup than others. If you top feed your plants with drippers or manually with a watering can, then you're probably going to be okay so long as you water regularly and achieve 20 to 30% runoff each time. Passive wicking systems and flood and drain, where plants are fed from the bottom and the capillary action of the roots draws up the nutrient solution, are more prone to salt buildup. As well as periodic leaching, there's also the more widely known pre-harvest flush. This is what most folks mean when they're talking about flushing. It's typically performed by growers cultivating plants which produce the majority of all of their harvest in one hit at the end. Yeah, okay. Like most determinate tomato varieties, for example. Usually, 2 weeks before the harvest, growers start to lower their nutrient concentrations. Just don't go straight into it with pure water. First, go half strength, and eventually, say in the last week to quarter strength. The idea is to encourage the plant to use up any residual nutrients within itself so that only pure plant flavors remain. Reverse osmosis water mixed with the flushing agent is the most aggressive flush and should be reserved for the final few days. The final flush is a balancing act. Start it out too early and you deny your plants important nutrients where they arguably need it the most, and it could hit your yield. Too late and you risk leaving excess residual minerals stored in plant tissue. Enzyme-based products and compost tea can be a good prelude to a pre-harvest flush as they help to break down any dead root material and allow nutrients from these to be fed back to the plant. Reducing the nutrient concentration signals to the plant that the end is near, just like when you stop offering seconds to your in-laws at holiday dinners, and can speed up the ripening process. Your plant's leaves, especially older lower leaves, will begin to turn pale and may even turn reddish-brown as mobile elements are drawn from them into the newer growth, buds, flowers, and fruits. This is a sign that your final pre-harvest flush is working. Also, when we start to starve the plant like this, we effectively force it to draw sugars from its larger, older leaves into the flowers and fruits themselves. Tobacco growers, for instance, feed with plenty of water prior to harvest to reduce nitrate content in the leaves, helping to improve flavor and create a better burn. Growers in NFT and DWC systems have the easiest time flushing because there's really not any growing media to leach of nutrients. You simply change out the reservoir and you're done. Coco coir growers may find it hard to flush out calcium and magnesium as this media tends to hold on to these elements for dear life. Using a coco and perlite mix makes it easier to leach effectively. Hydrogen expanded clay balls are relatively easy to leach as they don't really hold on to nutrient solution. However, if they do undergo a drying out period, the nutrient salts can dry on the outer surface and become insoluble. You see these often on the surface of the container where they can dry out under light and air movement. Grodan Stonewool is another easy pre-harvest flusher. It has zero CEC, so it easily lets go of residual nutrients. Mother Earth growstones are another great choice for the same reason peat-based potting mixes are harder to flush. Organic soil growers shouldn't worry about flushing at all. Simply build up the initial soil recipe. You can check out mine here. Use a liquid organic feed or top dress additional nutrients as and when required, and then switch to water a few weeks before harvest. To sum up, periodic leaching and pre-harvest flushing should be done gradually and carefully. It's really something quite specific to high-value consumable crops. You really won't find commercial cucumber hydroponic growers talking about this. However, the moral of this story is always be aware of the nutrient concentrations in your root zone as well as in your reservoir. I hope you found this helpful. Please don't forget to subscribe, and if you use Instagram and want to see what I'm cooking for dinner, or maybe a little something else, you can follow me there too. Just search for Everest F. I'll leave the F up to your imagination. Questions and comments below, you know the drill. This is Everest, fully fattened yet tasting exceptionally clean. Bye-bye.